and welcome to In Depth. I'm Tina Jha. Our topic today is the genetic modification of crops, also called GM crops, because the DNA of their seeds is altered to increase their resistance to pests and insects. Such changes, besides ensuring longevity, boost production, which is why GM foods are quite common in the West. India's experience, however, has been different. While BT cotton started with a lot of promise, in recent years, it began to suffer attacks by pests. Farmer unions and experts complain of losses, while farmers' suicides in cotton-growing areas introduced a new dimension to the debate. Another chapter was added to the GM story in India on the 11th of March 2018. This was when the Delhi High Court ruled that Monsanto, the company that provides GM seeds in India, cannot claim patents on its genetically modified cotton seeds as per law of the land. In our episode today, let's understand in detail what the verdict means, what GM technology is, and how do GM seeds impact crop productivity. The Delhi High Court verdict has once again initiated the debate in India over GM crops. The question before the court was whether royalties should be charged only on seeds or on the modified genes of that seed.
India's agrarian community comprises over 58% of its population. Residing in rural areas, farming is their principal means of livelihood. Farmers thus form the backbone of our economy. These are statements we've often read since childhood. Today, the stark reality is that farmers are the most distressed lot in the country. Farmer suicides are reported from all across the country. In 2017, the Centre informed the Supreme Court that despite a multi-pronged approach to improve income and social security of farmers, over 12,000 suicides were reported in the agricultural sector every year since 2013. There are many reasons that have led to the increasing spate of farmer suicides in India. Our lands are not as productive as before, markets are failing and debts are piling up, and pests cannot be kept at bay. Be it fertilizers, crop protection, chemicals, or even the seeds for cultivation, farming has become expensive for the already indebted farmers. In 1996, when the genetically modified seeds were approved for commercial use, it was widely claimed that it would not only increase production, but also bring profits to farmers. It's been 20 years since then, but the plight of farmers has not changed. Instead of bringing prosperity to the poor farmers, companies providing GM seeds have grown richer in recent years.
So what does the consumer get out of it? It's not cheaper. It is in no way better. It's not better tasting, it's not cheaper, but it is risky. So the consumer certainly is at a disadvantage, gets nothing. The farmer knows how to produce crops, and if you consider today's biggest bottleneck to improving production, it's water. The lack of water worldwide is recognized to be the biggest threat to agriculture and to the farmer's interests. So what is a GM seed going to do?
On the 11th of March 2018, the Delhi High Court ruled that Monsanto Company, the world's largest seed company, cannot own a patent over genetically modified cotton seeds in India. As a consequence, the patent held by Monsanto's Indian arm over its Bolgate 2 BT cotton seed technology was decreed unenforceable in the country. The ruling gave a new twist to the ongoing debate on BT cotton seeds and genetically modified technology in India. In all likelihood, Monsanto Company will appeal in the Supreme Court. But if the apex court upholds the verdict, then Indian companies may seek a reduction in royalties.
Monsanto had got a patent on the BT gene. So the question was whether producing any seed which contains the BT gene is a violation of their patent or not. What they were claiming was that since they have a patent on the BT gene, any seed which contains the BT gene is a violation of their patent, and therefore they are entitled to stop anybody else from selling a seed which has the BT gene. Now, how this issue arises is because in the Patents Act, you cannot patent a plant or a seed or any part of a plant.
BT cotton was the first genetically modified crop in India. It was introduced in 2002 by the Maharashtra Hybrid Seed Company in collaboration with Monsanto for commercial cultivation in 6 states belonging to southern and central cotton cultivation zones of the country. The foremost reason for the introduction of BT cotton was to counter insect pests that caused substantial damage to the crop, resulting in low productivity. At that time, it was claimed that GM seeds are resistant to the American and pink bollworm, thereby reducing the use of pesticides. Besides, GM seeds were also said to be drought and flood resistant. However, barely a few years after its introduction, the GM seeds' resistance to pests dropped. Last year, a report by the Central Institute of Cotton Research confirmed the seed was susceptible to the pink bollworm. A detailed study by the CICR said farmers' ignorance about the technology, topped by non-compliance of an important regulatory requirement by seed companies, was the main reason why the pink bollworm developed resistance in India. Under the regulatory guidelines, farmers who plant BT cotton must also plant another cotton variety without the BT gene in 20% of the total BT crop area. The purpose of this is to prevent pests from developing resistance to the BT toxins by diverting them to the non-BT crops called refuge plants. To enable farmers to comply with the refuge requirement, seed companies are required to provide a packet of 120 gram non-BT cotton or refuge seeds with every 450 gram packet of BT cotton seeds. But the study found that the refuge seeds sold by companies had poor germination and were found to have a significant quantity of BT seeds mixed in them and did not act as refuge due to a significantly different reproductive window period. The National Seed Association of India has asked the Union Government to declare the two-gene trait of the genetically modified cotton seed as ineffective against the pink bollworm. With inputs from Leena Sharma, Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
Controversies are not new to GM crops in India. From the time the concept of GM crops was introduced in the country, there have been some of the other debates related to their use. In this report, let's understand a few of these debates.
In India, genetically modified crops or GM crops are regulated by Ministry of Environment and Forest. However, the safety aspects of GM crops are assessed by three committees that function as a statutory body under the ministry. The committees include the Institutional Biosafety Committees or IBSCs, Review Committee on Genetic Manipulation or RCGM, and Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee or GEAC. The committees are responsible for granting permits for environmental release and cultivation only after undergoing elaborate food and environmental safety assessment. But since 2011, it has become mandatory to take permission from the state governments to conduct experimental and large-scale open field trials of these GM crops. The only GM crop permitted for cultivation in the country is BT cotton. It was approved by the government in 2002. At present, 10 states have been cultivating genetically modified or GM cotton.
The question is whether you can have a patent at all in a plant or a seed. The Patents Act is very clear. There is a complete exclusion under Section 3J. You cannot patent a plant or a part of a plant or a seed. Therefore, if you have a genetically modified seed, you cannot have a patent on it. As to whether you can have any protection in it, you can have a protection under the Plant Varieties Act. So if it is the exact same variety which has been developed by them, then you cannot use that variety without their permission.
Under the UPA 2 regime, the then government approved 10 food crops including wheat, paddy, cotton, jowar, bajra and maize for experimentation. But in 2010, then Environment Minister Jairam Ramesh banned the trials. On the issue of GM crops, for the first time, the Standing Committee on Agriculture did a thorough investigation in 2013 and 14. The committee held 27 meetings. It also held discussions with experts in this field, after which the committee came to the conclusion that besides posing risk to human and animal health, the genetically modified crops also pose threat to other crops.
Sole benefits of GM seeds are to the producers and sellers of GM seeds, not really to the farmer or not to the consumer. The consumer is exposed to unnecessary risk of toxicity, maybe eating something poisonous. I'm not saying everything is poisonous, but you have a chance that it is poisonous. You have a chance you could be allergic to it. So what does the consumer get out of it? It's not cheaper. It is in no way better. It's not better tasting. It's not cheaper, but it is risky. So the consumer certainly is at a disadvantage, gets nothing. The farmer knows how to produce crops.
American agricultural biotech giant Monsanto and Myco have been engaged to develop BT cotton in India since 1996. They claim that such a gene has been transplanted in cotton that have helped to minimize the damages caused by pests like bollworm. With this, production of cotton in the country nearly doubled in 2002. Opponents, however, said even though BT cotton was inedible crop but might impact on health. However, the government claimed that BT cotton will provide white gold.
Monsanto was charging a huge amount as royalty or trade fee for these seeds, which made these BT cotton seeds very, very expensive, and which ultimately had to come from the farmer, because if they charge a high royalty, then the farmer has to ultimately pay it. So this will be a big relief to the farmer, because the government had intervened in between, and that is how the whole dispute arose. The government had fixed a cap on the trade value.
The Indian Agricultural Research Institute and Agricultural University of India are doing research on 22 GM crops, including grains, oil seeds, pulses and cotton. In 2004, agriculture scientist Dr. M.S. Swaminathan accepted that its use could double food production and will also ensure the adequate nutrition to the crop. However, it also argued that GM crops will push farmers into debt, as they will lose their sovereign right over the seeds as they are forced to buy GM seeds and technologies for multinational corporations. With inputs from Arvind Kumar Singh, Leena Sharma for Rajya Sabha TV.
Since the use of genetically modified seeds is not widespread in India, there is a lot of curiosity about the topic, like how and when were they developed, what was the need to produce them, and who are the people who first used this technology. Let's find out the answers in this report.
John Gregor Mendel laid the foundation of genetic engineering in the 18th century. Between 1856 and 1863, Mendel conducted experiments that led him to discover the fundamental laws of inheritance. These are known as Mendel's laws of heredity. Several years later, in 1954, James Watson and Francis Crick discovered the double helix structure of the DNA. This gave an all-new dimension to genetic engineering. The DNA theory provided answers to many of the nature's mysteries, paving the way for genetically modified crops. In 1970, John Franz, a research chemist working for an American company, Monsanto, discovered the glyphosate class of herbicides. Glyphosate can eliminate more than 125 kinds of weeds, and it is non-toxic to animals. Monsanto marketed the herbicide under the name Roundup. It became popular, and Monsanto went a step further, developing genetically modified seeds that would resist its own herbicide Roundup, and also patented the seeds. In 1972-73, American biochemists Herbert Boyer and Stanley Cohen developed recombinant DNA technology. This was a technique to cut and paste DNA from one organism to the other to create what became the first custom-made organism containing recombined DNA. The year 1976 saw the beginning of commercialization of biotechnology. Medical, food, and chemical industries started making use of advancements in genetic engineering. In 1980, the United States Supreme Court ruled that a genetically modified bacterium can be patented.
When you can create a genetically modified seed, you're actually forcefully pushing in genes from any source. In the case of BT cotton or BT brinjal, it is forcing bacterial genes, genes taken from bacteria, into cotton.
In 1988, the first genetically modified varieties of glyphosate-resistant soybeans were produced. These became popular among farmers, after which similar experiments were done with potato, cotton, paddy, sugarcane and tomato crops. Some reports say the first genetically modified plant was a tobacco crop, produced in 1982. In 1994, a genetically modified variety of tomato entered the American markets. These tomatoes reportedly stay fresh for much longer than the normal variety. In the year 2000, scientists developed genetically modified golden rice that were more nutritious than the ordinary rice. In India, BT cotton passed the legal hurdle in 2002. This was the first commercial genetically modified crop to be grown in India. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
It's also important to know what genetically modified crops or seeds are and how they are prepared. Genetic modification makes it possible to change an organism's DNA. Let's find out how it's done.
In GM technology, the DNA of a gene is first inserted into the genome of an organism. This DNA then turns into cells, after which they finally grow into plants using tissue culture. The seeds produced by these plants are inherited from the new DNA, that is GM DNA. That is, in the seeds produced by these plants, the DNA of the GM seeds become inherently involved. The characteristics of the organism or plant depends on their genetic makeup and their synergy with the environment. The cause of change in an organism's genetic form is its genome, which is made of DNA. Genomes have fixed areas of genes and DNA that are usually helpful in making proteins. This protein determines the characteristics of any plant or organism. For genetic mutation of plants in GM technology, a special part of an organism or plant's DNA is introduced in the genome so that it can develop new or different properties, through which the capacity of resistance is determined. The new DNA then becomes part of the genome of the GM plant, which is included in the seeds produced by these plants.
Genetically modified seeds are seeds that nature cannot produce, which means that if there is a cross between two human beings, you can only have another human being as a child. If two pigs cross, you will only have a pig. If two donkeys cross, you will only have a donkey. If wheat crosses with wheat, you will have wheat. So nature has evolved a certain kind of evolutionary balance. When you can create a genetically modified seed, you're actually forcefully pushing in genes from any source. In the case of BT cotton or BT brinjal, it is forcing bacterial genes, genes taken from bacteria, into cotton. Now that is something completely unnatural.
There are several methods used to genetically modify plants. In the most popular method, DNA is bound to tiny particles of gold or tungsten, which are subsequently shot into plant tissue or single plant cells under high pressure. In other ways, bacterium or virus is used, which turn their DNA into separate cells. Agrobacterium tumefaciens is another common technique, under which the genes are inserted into bacterial and bacterial cells and the new DNA converts to the genome of that plant. The development of new plants is possible because each cell of different plants has the capacity to develop a whole new plant.
When you do something that is against nature and that is so aggressive and forceful is actually bombarding a plant with genes, in this case bacterial genes, then the plant can react and can produce products that can be either poisonous or they can be harmful, then they can create allergies.
GM technology is known by many names, including gene technology, recombinant DNA technology and genetic engineering. According to the World Health Organization, DNA in GM organisms is changed in such a way that there is no naturally occurring reproduction process. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
While supporters of GM crops argue that these crops are pest resistant and have a higher yield, many experts feel GM crops have potential adverse effects in the long run, and they outweigh the benefits by far. Our next report details the impact of GM crops on our agricultural sector and also on the farmers.
The key reason for the initial popularity of the BT cotton was a drastic reduction in the use of pesticides due to its pest-resistant features. Traditionally, cotton consumed more insecticides than any other crop in India, with over 166 types of pests attacking the crop, especially American bollworm, which could damage up to 60% of the total crop. In 1996, India opened its doors to genetically modified crops to tackle the pest threat. By then, 25 countries were already using the GM cotton crop. However, it wasn't long before the ill effects of the GM crop began to appear. Fields where BT cotton was grown recorded a major depletion of nutrients in the soil. Used as fodder for cattle, it led to an adverse impact on milk production. This triggered a continuing debate on the impact of genetically modified crops on the human body and natural food chain.
The first few years of BT cotton were a complete failure. Then there was some cotton that was cultivated in irrigated areas with very large inputs, which produced good harvests, but not in areas that were unirrigated. There it was always a failure, always a difficult crop. Always leading, you keep hearing about farmer suicides, mostly in areas where there have been cash crops. BT cotton areas have seen large suicides. That was the whole reason why BT cotton was created. It is going to be resistant to the bollworm, a big pest. It's not. The bollworm has become resistant to BT cotton now.
BT cotton also impacted the Indian varieties of cotton crops. Indian agricultural scientists had developed 250 varieties of cotton. Apart from these, there were some local varieties too, which disappear as the BT cotton took over. However, BT cotton also led to an increased production in the country. India is the largest producer of cotton in the world, accounting for about 26% of the world cotton production. Cotton is grown in 110 lakh hectares in India. India's average production is 510 kilograms per hectare, while the global average is 700 kilograms per hectare. BT cotton accounts for 90% of cotton produced in India. The biggest beneficiaries of the BT cotton are the multinational seed companies.
The case of the Indian seed companies, Nuzi Vidu, was, look, the moment you introduce the BT gene in a seed, the patent ceases to apply. And therefore, you cannot have a patent in a seed, and therefore you cannot injunct us. The moment it is introduced in a plant or a seed, the patentability goes. That was the issue. So the Delhi High Court has held that no, they have agreed with the Indian seed companies, disagreed with Monsanto, and said that the moment it is in a seed or a plant, that is not patentable, and therefore Monsanto cannot injunct the Indian seed companies.
Monsanto firm earns more than 250 crores annually through marketing of GM seeds in India. The company earned over 10,000 crore rupees between 2000 to 2008 from royalties. BT cotton seeds are sold at prices nearly 200 times than the normal seeds. Initially, Maharashtra Hybrid Seed Company and Monsanto had kept the prices of 450 GMBT cotton seeds at 1800 rupees. Although the prices were reduced later, but there is no regulation on its prices once it reached local seed companies and shopkeepers in rural areas. Besides, fake BT cotton seeds are also available in the market. Many farmers fall into a cycle of debt from the purchase of expensive, commercialized BT cotton seeds and chemical inputs that then fail to yield enough to sustain their livelihoods.
The moment to say what are the benefits, I would say the sole benefits of GM seeds are to the producers and sellers of GM seeds, not really to the farmer or not to the consumer. The consumer is exposed to unnecessary risk of toxicity, maybe eating something poisonous. If you really want to help the farmer, provide soil nutrients and provide water. Then you will get a crop. Then you can double your production.
Although a few scientists argue that the fear has been instilled in farmers' mind against the use of GM crops, they argue there are no safety concerns regarding the use of GM seeds in the country. But what is worrying is even after so many years since being introduced, almost 75% GM seeds in India are distributed by private players. A national gene bank exists to address concerns regarding GM crops in India, but more stringent laws are required. With inputs from Zaiga Murtaza, Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And that's it from us in this edition of In Depth. We'll see you same time on Monday now. Thanks for watching.